Good morning. This is Mr. Rogers, and we are here talking about tsunamis and earthquake damage today. And one thing I want to point out right away before we really get into the notes of the day, I want to point out that there's a lot of video clips that go along with this lesson today. And what I decided to do was load all those onto the playlist on YouTube. So if you go to the Willowbrook Science YouTube channel, and you can see your earthquake damage. There are seven video clips, and they're all fairly short. I think 15 seconds. The longest one, I think, is 2 minutes long. But they're all really worthwhile, and they all kind of go right along with the lesson for today. So I really suggest that you can either stop the lesson as I talk and go look at them, or after I'm done, please go watch those videos because I think they really do reinforce what I'm talking about today. So today, guys, we're talking about tsunamis and earthquake damage. And what happens here, the big thing about this section is, what are some of the really the big risks from earthquakes? What kind of damage can they cause? Then also, how do we protect ourselves the best we can from that damage? So, the severe shaking produced by seismic waves can damage or destroy buildings, bridges, topple utility poles, and fracture gas and water mains. And that's really some of the big dangers is what they break in earthquakes. I have a few photos down here you can kind of see. I believe this is from the 89 quake in San Francisco where the upper structure of the highway was flattened like a pancake. And we had these buildings kind of collapse. And the big problem is when you build with concrete's very strong, it supports a lot of weight. But if that foundation rocks or moves too much, concrete's not meant to bend, and that's when all this damage occurs. Oop, go off of that. So, moving on here, guys. So, what are some of the damages that happens? What happens? Buildings built on solid rock will have less damage than building on loose soil. And we'll talk more about this in future days, but this kind of goes to the fact of it depends what you're sitting on when the earthquake happens. If you're on solid rock, like bedrock beneath your feet, you're in a lot better shape. If you're on more of that loose soil, like around lake beds, around rivers, a lot more loose dirt, that tends to amplify the seismic waves and make that earthquake damage even worse. One of the big things that can happen is something called liquefaction. I did say that right, it's liquefaction. Liquefaction occurs when the shaking from an earthquake turns loose soft soil into liquid mud. This often happens when you have a hard cement layer on top, and a layer or two down you have a lot of sediment, a lot of sandy soil, and if there's a lot of water in there, you basically have the ingredients for like making a milkshake. And so when you add that earthquake, add that vibrations, that water and that sand gets mixed together. What happens here, you can see from this photo, that these layers start to mix and the sand comes up, a lot of times it causes the ground to collapse. And so this sometimes can damage buildings that are on that surface as these liquefaction holes occur. Sometimes the ground will just sink altogether. So it's really one of those dangers of that happens during or right after an earthquake is the idea of liquefaction. It's basically we have a lot of water, you have a lot of loose soil, loose sediment, we'd say. And when it mixes, it causes a lot of damage to the surrounding structures. All right. So from there, guys, it's kind of how do we prevent? How do we try to stop earthquakes from damaging? Because let's face it, a large percentage of the population of the Earth live in these earthquake zones. Think about the Ring of Fire. And so what we can do, some construction methods to help us out. We can anchor buildings on soil to nearby solid rock. And that's just kind of one simple way to make sure you're anchored to rock. You don't want to build on that loose soil when you know you're in an earthquake zone. But again, that tends to amplify and make those vibrations even worse from seismic waves. The one big thing I've highlighted here is the idea of a base isolated building. And again, in the videos, on that video playlist on the channel, I have a couple of really good videos that show the idea of a base isolated building in action. But a base isolated building is designed to reduce the amount of energy that reaches the building during an earthquake. So what happens here the idea that the earthquake when it comes is going to tends to vibrate that ground sometimes side to side, sometimes up and down. And what the base isolated building is really meant to do is it's meant to kind of absorb. You can see that these springs down here at the bottom. It's meant to absorb that side-to-side motion. So instead of the building rocking back and forth, just that base is going to kind of isolate it so it kind of rocks back and forth on its own. Again, I have some good videos if you look at the YouTube playlist associated with earthquake damage, does a couple good videos of that. So what else can also can happen, and this is probably the most commonly known, we think of tsunamis, that idea of a tsunami. And there have been some pretty big tsunamis in the past 2 years, so it's kind of been in the news a lot, so you've probably heard about a tsunami before. But a tsunami occurs when a quake is strong enough, the water displaced by the quake forms these large waves. And I have a picture here. And the big idea, you know, a typical wave, you see it out in the ocean, it comes in and it breaks. It breaks on the shoreline, and then it rolls back into the ocean. So it looks ominous coming in, but it breaks and, you know, it's typically fairly harmless. With a tsunami, it's going to look a lot the same way. You have this giant, looks like a wave of water coming in, but instead of breaking, there's, you know, a wall of water behind it. And that wave just keeps coming in over the shoreline. Now, tsunamis, these giant waves of water, they can be a few inches tall, not really cause any damage at all. They can be a few feet, moderate damage. You know, if you go over 10 feet, you get that really severe damage caused by this. Because a lot of times, if it happens along the coastline where there's very little warning of a tsunami coming, people don't really have time to prepare for it. So tsunamis do happen. And again, if you go to my YouTube channel, I've got a couple good videos showing the actual tsunami of Japan in March 2011. You actually see it coming onto shore, and it's really it's kind of a eye-opening thing to see how this, that water is coming onto shore. So I encourage you again to go back and look at that also. All right, guys. So from there, we're going to stop our lesson today. And again, I encourage you to go look at those video clips on tsunamis, on base isolated buildings, and just some general things on how damage earthquakes can cause also. So I encourage you to go do that after you watch this video. So I thank you guys for watching today, and we'll see you tomorrow.